Well, you guys, welcome to Easter Chapel. How you doing? I don't feel the love right now. Thank you. Okay, we have got a lot going on today. It's kind of different than some we've done before. I think you're going to really enjoy it. Kind of goes from the feeling of a little bit of despair to a whole lot of joy. Do you think maybe that was Easter week? You know, I think that was Easter week. So we're kind of doing a little bit of the feeling of the week. Okay? So just really soak it in. Get ready for Good Friday to think about our Lord's gift to us. And then Saturday, the quiet day, we'll call it. And then Sunday, the day of joy. So we're going to go through all those things. So let me pray and then we'll begin. Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for your gift. What a gift. And I'm just very grateful to you for that today. And I pray that we would listen to each word spoken, each word sung, and just know that that gift was for us. Amen.
Six days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here, a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served, while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it.
Leave her alone. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me.
Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well, for on account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jesus and believing in him. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip, in turn, told Jesus. Jesus told them,
the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name.
Thank you. lost. Everything is lost. And everything I've loved before is gone. Alone, like the coming of the frost in a cold winter's chill. In my stony heart, where were you when all that I hoped for? Where were you when I was in fear? Came crashing down in shambles around. Could you take away the pain? If I find someone to blame, would it make my life seem easier? Alone, all my friends are asleep, and I can't find anyone to stay awake with me. Sin stole my innocence. Where were you when I was ashamed? Hiding in a life I wish I never made. You were on the cross. You were on the cross. My God, my God, all alone, all alone. You were on the cross. My God, my God, all alone, all victorious, all alone, all alone. And you were there in all of my suffering. In fear, I'm waiting on the dawn to
picture, if you will, a hill. And on that hill, a road leading down to a hub of humanity, a city. And on that road, a young donkey carrying a load. Not a load of produce nor of anything, but a king. What's a king doing riding on a donkey? That doesn't click. Doesn't make a lick of sense. Kings should be majestic, at the very least on a horse. Of course, even better, on a prancing steed so that king could proceed with pride. But instead, this king sits on the hide of a beast of burden for his ride. But there's more. Crowds gathered and roared like waves on a shore. People took what they wore, their clothes, their coats if they had them, palm branches they cut and bestowed on that king riding, accolades, words of praise, their eyes ablaze with the fire of adoration, the elation that their expectation, their salvation had arrived. That crowd was loud. But not everybody breathed words of celebration. Not everyone shouted with words of acclaim. For this king's fame, how he had healed the lame and how demons feared his name, threatened the status quo of the religious who's who, VIPs, guys whose faith was in a deep freeze and whose religion smelled as bad as old cheese. The sound of the crowds cheering set their teeth on edge. Every last one of them would pledge their last cent if only they could circumvent the extent of what this man meant to the people. So they shouted too, not in praise, but in anger. They said to the king, "Hey, how dare you encourage this nonsense? Have you no conscience? Tell this swarm of idiots to shut up." I digress. Maybe I should tell you a little more about this king. The one on the donkey, here's the thing. He is no ordinary monarch. His reign carries the hallmark of greatness. There is no single country that could hold his importance, no land that could contain his immenseness. You see, he was and he is to come, God Almighty, wearing flesh for a time, in order to save fallen mankind. Now back to the story. Those dudes that were yelling and telling the king to quiet the crowd that was too loud, he didn't, by the way. His will held sway. He told them if they had only paid better attention and looked in his book, they might have understood the significance and had a little less indifference to the importance of that day. That day, the prophets of old had foretold this exact story, even the part about the donkey. So if there's a lesson to be learned, a prize to be earned for paying attention, did I mention that pledging loyalty to this king is a life or death situation? Take a page from that crowd and with head bowed, let the king reign in your heart. It's the very best part. It's a head start to heaven.
Thank you.
No. Anybody standing up over there? Thank you, though, for responding like that. That just made me super happy. Ow, I just hit myself in the mouth with this. Okay, if you guys are standing up, we're not going to sit down again, so come on in the chairs. Yeah. You guys, I'm going to say something before we start. That during her presentation, I never heard whispering stop. Not for 1 second. Now, you might have been saying, wow, that's neat. That's what I'm hoping it was. Guys, this is, what did she say? What was her last line? Do you remember? A life and death. And we're whispering. So let's listen to the songs, okay? That was your amen. Have a good day.